Isn't it great that
yeah.
our God is good? So come with us if you are here or online and just, yeah, give it all to God because He's why we're here. And so, yeah, just lay it all down and let's continue our worship and, yeah. I search the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise was treasures that fade, are never enough.
Then you came along and put me back together, and
it's yellow and hurts if it gets stuck in your eye. A bulldozer.
His friend ducks.
How do cows keep up to date? They need a moo paper.
What do you call a beehive without any sexes?
Unbelievable.
A priest, a Baptist minister, and a rabbit turn up to give blood, and the nurse asks them, what blood type are you? And the rabbit says, I'm probably a typo.
Dance. Put a little boogie in it.
What's green and has wheels?
Grass. I hide about the wheels.
An apple a day keeps the doctor away. At least it does if you throw it hard enough.
Why did the toilet roll down the hill? To get to the bottom.
So when does a dad joke become a dad joke?
Obviously,
I was applying for an Australian citizenship and the interviewer asked me, do you have a criminal record? I said, is that still a requirement?
What do you call a sad cup of coffee? Depresso.
Hang on, I gotta remember to do it first.
How do you follow that? Pretty hard to. Hey, welcome to Hamilton Central Baptist this morning. Just take a moment, stay where you're seated, just wave to those people that you know this morning and see if you can arrange to do coffee with them in the cafe afterwards. Take one moment to do that. All organised? Wow, we're efficient, which is pretty cool. Hey, welcome everybody this morning. Great to see you here this morning. For those that are dads, a special welcome to you. But really, we welcome everybody on this wonderful Father's Day. On a day that we remember that it's our Father in Heaven who really is the model of the greatest Father that we have. After the service, we're going to have some manly dadly food in the cafe for you all. So hope you stay, take time to hang out and enjoy the atmosphere, unlike on the moon. We have a number of neighbourhood discernment groups going on at the moment around the city. Wave at me if you've already started. Cool. Wave harder if you're enjoying it. It's pretty cool. The one that I'm in is we're having a lot of fun. We have some, and a lot of food, which is good. It's a very Baptist way of doing things. We do it with food. We have a number of groups starting up and they are here at Hamilton Central Baptist Church during the daytime. And they will start after next Sunday. When will they start? Next Sunday. That's exactly right. So on Sunday the 11th at 4 o'clock in the cafe, there'll be a group. Bring a plate if you want to be involved in that one. And that's a really good one if you've got small children, because it's from 4 o'clock till about 6 o'clock, I guess. So a good family-friendly time to do that. On Monday the 12th, there will be one at 7 p.m. Bring supper to share for that one. And on Wednesday the 14th at 10 a.m., that one starts. And that's a morning tea one, and the morning tea will be provided. So those three will be starting up. When do they start up? Thank you. That's really good. All right. We're in a new series at the moment, a series called Get Used to Different with a byline of His Words, His Way, My Life. We've been enjoying that. Hopefully you've been enjoying the devotions. There are new devotions out for this week. Along with that comes a memory verse to do for you to remember. And those are in the bulletin this morning. So if you've got your bulletin, you'll find those with there this morning. Coming up on the 25th, looking ahead, the 25th of September, we're going to have a baptismal service in the morning, in our morning service time. If you have been wondering about being baptized, it's something that you haven't done yet, can I ask you to pray about that? Is this your next step in your walk with Jesus? If you've wanted to know a little more about baptism, you can email reception at HCBC and someone will get back to you, or you can see one of the pastors and have a conversation about that. Baptism is that wonderful declaration of your faith in public where you join with your family of God here and you declare that you're going to get serious with God. This is a wonderful thing to do. Let's pray for our family and on this wonderful Father's Day. Lord, we come before you this morning, our Father in heaven. We recognize that you are the model of the greatest Father there ever is. You know us so well. We give you thanks, Lord, for all of your love and all of the gifts that you bestow upon us. You know what we need in time before we even need it. And Father, as we think of us as a church community, we give you thanks for all the love and the provision that you have. We thank you for those that give every week in terms of the running of the church electronically or bring their tithes and offerings in every week and faithfully give. And Father, we simply pray that we would be honest and hear your word as we discern your direction for the church. We give it all back to you and say, Lord, have your way with us. We pray all of this in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Brian. I'm one of the pastors here. And to our dads, happy eat what you want, sleep in front of the TV when you want day. And hope you have a happy, happy Father's Day. Hey, you'll notice inside the newsletter, we've been highlighting a few of our different ministry areas. And today we want to highlight what we now call our generations ministry. So could you please welcome up to the stage Pastor Sarah Barnett. Come on up. There you go. So you are now the pastor of a new ministry, new change we made, called Generations Ministry. Can you tell us a little bit, what does that cover? What ages, what is that about?
So from my understanding, it covers from preschool, so our under fives program, right up to overseeing how our young adults ministry is run and what they're doing. So in between that is the primary, intermediate, high school, and all those ages, yeah.
Cool. And now that's a lot of ages.
Yep.
0 to 20-something. So who's your favorite age? No, don't answer that. what do you like about this? What do you like about working with all these different ages and the transitions and things? What is it that you kind of love about this new idea?
Yeah, no, it's really cool. My background is actually in teaching, and so I was in early childhood teaching. And so for me, it's really cool to be able to journey with a young person right from they're young, developing, and understanding the world, and learning new things, and discovering who God is, and who God is in them, and all that sort of thing, and seeing them grow and develop. As they get older, their understanding gets deeper and deeper. And I sit in this really unique position at the moment, which is pretty cool, that in my youth ministry, I have young people that when I was teaching, I taught in early childhood, which was at a church center, so it was cool, I could talk to them about Jesus. And now I get to talk to them about Jesus again as teenagers, which is really cool, really special, and so it's nice to be able to have my hand on that now and be able
nice.
To influence that in a church setting rather than in a ECE and school setting stuff. Yeah.
Brilliant. Now, look, while you're paid to be everywhere, and with all those people all the time, it's just not possible. No. So you need a team. What kind of people, what kind of leaders are you looking for to be a part of this team that helps introduce all these different ages to Jesus?
There's no real requirements for someone that can serve in ministry. These are varied ages, there's varied skills, there's varied abilities that can come with that. But just having a heart for serving, a heart for God and our young people to know and learn more about Jesus. And so just being someone that's approachable, someone that's friendly and willing to learn. We can teach you what you need to do. There's lots of different things. So yeah, just someone that's passionate about God, wants to see our community build and feed into the next generation or the current generation. I don't know why I said next generation, but our young people are our current generation and they're the ones that are going to follow us through. And so how do we feed into them and how do we grow them? And yeah. So yeah, just someone that's excited about that and is willing to maybe put themselves in an uncomfortable position. I'm okay with young people, but there's definitely times where I'm like, oh, that age, I'm not the favorite. But you know, like there's different things, and I understand that if you're older, kids can be scary, teenagers can be super scary, but kind of not. I always tell my teenagers that although I'm ECE trained, their brains are the same as a preschooler, so it's fine. It's pretty easy to talk to. Their brains aren't working very well, so yeah.
All right, so here's your future team. Let's pick a few.
Oh yeah.
All right, let's just pick a few. So I think the trick here is, how do you know you're being asked by God to join Sarah and working with these different ages. And I tell you right now, if your palms are feeling a little sweaty, that's God telling you. Yep. If you're sitting there going, thinking, I've done this before, not again, that's probably God telling you. I think if you can remember an age group, an age where I remember what it was like being intermediate and awkward, and the boys going up and down, and then go back up, you remember that, or you remember what it was like to sit in Sunday school and hear a story of Jesus and see it come alive on the flannel graph, and you're like, whoa, or you remember high school, and you remember that. Now your memories of high school is that it was great, but if you went back in time, you realize how it probably wasn't so great, and you know that. Maybe God's tapping you on the shoulder and say, would you like to walk beside a young person and help them know Jesus? Help them know how much he loves them, how much he values them, that they've got this amazing life ahead of them. And yeah, it's hard, and life's goofy, and the world's weird, but you're never alone. Because not only do you have Jesus, you have us. And we're going to walk with you through this. If that makes you lean forward, how can I get involved?
Well, conveniently, this afternoon after church, we're catching up with our ministry team. So those predominantly that are serving in our preschool and primary school program, because we don't have enough people to run our intermediates program at the moment. So if this doesn't mean that your palms are sweaty, God is prompting on you, and you're like, I'm just going to be busy that afternoon. It's actually today. We're going to catch up after church in the children's room, which is down around the corner. And we're just going to chat about what that looks like, how we can best help you to serve, because I don't want to be putting you on rosters every other week and then you're like, oh, this is too much. But it's a conversation. What does ministry look like? I'm still figuring out what this all looks like so we can figure it out together. And how can I work best with you to help use our young people journey towards Christ? And our young people need parents, extra grandparents, extra nannies and stuff to just journey with them and to get to know them, know their names, say hello in the cafe. And it can start by just hanging out with them in the children's ministry rooms.
Brilliant. Hey, would you please join me as we pray for Sarah and the teams that she's a part of and our young people. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for Sarah and her love for you and her love for our young people who are growing in love with you every day. Thank you for the many people that are already part of our children's ministry and our intermediate ministry and our high school ministry. Thank you for their love for you and their love for our young people and how they have been walking beside people already, pointing them to your son, Jesus. God, we pray for our young folks that in a world today that just makes them question everything about life, thank you that they can do that on stable, solid ground. They can do that beside family, besides friends, beside a church family. Most importantly, they can do it beside you and your spirit as you guide and lead them on what it means to be like you, Jesus, in all situations. And thank you for the joy and the gift it is to be a leader that gets to watch them win like that and celebrate the going through the hard stuff and seeing Jesus come to the party, get to celebrate the life change and the big milestones of accepting Jesus and baptism and leading their friend to Jesus and going on mission trips and experiencing God's presence at camps and being a friend of a friend of a friend as they learn to navigate life together. Thank you for the gift that is to our leaders and to Sarah to see that. And then God, thank you that of the gift to Sarah and who she is to our young people and to her teams. Continue to encourage her every day. Remind her of what she's doing. Remind her of how you're involved. Help her to see life change in people's lives, to have those memories that keep her walking forward, trusting you as she walks through some hard stuff with kids and teens and is always by their side regardless of what's going on. So give them all hope. Hope in your presence, hope in your son, Jesus. And then God, for those of us here that are feeling a nudge and said, oh, maybe I'm supposed to help out with the kids. Maybe I'm supposed to help out with the teens. Give them the courage to just give Sarah a call, to send an email, to find out more. And God, we pray for the people you want to lead to these teams because the harvest is plentiful. The workers are few, but you got a plan. So thank you for the team that you're developing that's going to reach the friends of our teens and their friends with the message and the hope and the person of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you so much, Sarah. Appreciate that. Hey, let's prepare as we dive into the Sermon on the Mount again. Have a look at this video.
Throw me like a stone in the water. Watch the mud rise up.
If we're going to have a question and answer session every time we do something you're not used to, it's going to be a very annoying time together for all of us.
There are righteous men on the lookout for you, and they are weighing every word you say.
That's not for you.
This is different.
Get used to different.
We didn't choose him. He chose us.
I see you.
Oh, I really don't like that man.
Follow me, and you'll see more.
I was one way, and now I am completely different. And the thing that happened in between was him.
And so it's time.
Let's go.
So we are continuing our brand new series called Get Used to Different as we are taking some time to hear the words of Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount as he tells us, well, you know what? Actually, my father meant something a little bit different. He meant something different than what you may be doing to Christianity. I read a story on the internet, so you know it's got to be true, right? And on this thing, it was a story about the days before smartwatches, all right, way before smartwatches. And a guy at the airport was rushing around trying to find his flight. He was panicking. He didn't know how much time he had left. He needed to know what time it was. And he sees a guy walking towards him carrying two suitcases, and he notices he's got a watch on his hand. So he says, "Excuse me, sir, could you please tell me the time?" And the guy says, "Sure." And he puts these two big, heavy suitcases down he's been carrying. He looks at his watch, and he says, "Well, it's exactly 5:09 p.m. Temperature outside is about 20 degrees. It looks like it's going to be a cold front moving in. It's supposed to rain tonight, approximately 10:03 p.m. tonight. In London, where I'm heading, it's actually a nice, warm, balmy 30 degrees. But the barometer there says it's 29.14 and falling. Incidentally, Singapore is a beautiful day there today. And by the way, there should be a full moon here in Auckland tonight." And the other guy goes, "Your watch can tell you all of that?" And he says, "Well, yeah, I invented it. It's one of a kind." And the guy goes, "I'll give you $2,000 for it right now, cash, $2,000. I got to have that watch." And he goes, "Well, no, it's not for sale." And he goes down to pick up his two suitcases. He's about to walk away. He goes, "Okay, wait. Okay, $4,000. I'll give you $4,000 for it." He goes, "Look, I invented it. It's not for sale." He goes, okay. $10,000, $10,000 right now, cash in hand. I've got to have that watch." And the stranger goes, "Okay." He puts the suitcases down, takes the watch off. "For $10,000, I'll sell it to you." Gives him the watch. And as the stranger starts to put the watch on his wrist and walks away, the original guy goes, wait, you forgot the batteries. And he hands him the two big suitcases. Welcome to religion. Turns out that for a lot of people, you hear these incredible stories, testimonies about what religion can do, what faith can do for them, that it gives them a sense of purpose, which is amazing, that it gives them a sense of forgiveness and cleansing and a fresh start, which is awesome, that it gives you a sense of peace and joy and love, and they go, "Yes, I'll take it. And then they come to church, and we give them these big, heavy, extra baggage to carry around. A lot of heavy burdens to now carry, a lot of complications and extra requirements and legalistic rules that they were not expecting to come with this message of new life and abundant life in Jesus. Pastor Chuck Swindoll puts the problem this way in his book called Simple Faith. He says, for a lot of people, getting religion means this: enter complications, exit joy. And if that describes your Christian experience, if that describes your church experience, I've got great news for you today. Because the baggage isn't supposed to come with the deal. Jesus came to restore joy, to reduce complication in life. So let's talk today about a different kind of Christianity. What is Christianity, which often comes with heavy burdens and extra expectations? What's it supposed to be according to Jesus Christ? What's it supposed to be about? If Jesus was to come today to earth and start a ministry right here in the Tron and was to do a sermon by the river instead of on the mount, I thought that was so clever when I did it. What kind of Christianity would he talk about? What would he talk about? Would it look different than the way Christianity has kind of turned out to be like for you? Would it be different from the church that you grew up in? Would it be different from our church right now? See, this week's focus on the Sermon on the Mount, chapter 5, we're picking up at verse 7 today, gives us a great clue as to how Jesus would critique the overall Christian church, how he would evaluate you as a follower of Jesus by the way he criticized back then his own religion and its leaders. Because the Pharisees of Jesus' day, they were world champion complicators. That's what they did. They added so much extra baggage to following God. They added 613 rules to the Ten Commandments that God gave us. They added over 1,500 amendments to those 613 rules. They knew how to complicate things. Like when you washed your hands, the water had to run to the edge of your elbow and come off by itself, or it didn't count. It didn't count. You were not spiritually clean if it didn't run off the elbows like that. There were thousands of rules like this. Jesus Christ comes. And in the Sermon on the Mount, he says, let me strip away all the excess. Let's get rid of the extra additional baggage. Let's get back to the point of what drew you to faith in God in the first place. Another way to put it is, how does Jesus want me to live? How does he want us to then live? What kind of followers does Jesus want to follow him? What does Jesus want from me? Have you ever taken the time to just ask that? Jesus, what is it that you want from me? So in the passage that we're looking at today, Jesus kind of sets up like his thesis. It's like a thesis for the rest of the Sermon on the Mount and pretty much for the rest of his ministry on earth, actually, as well. He gives us four themes. We're going to look at four themes that really kind of end up being the four main themes for the rest of his life. This is like his platform. This is his mission statement. This is like his vision statement right up front. So if you want to know what Jesus is all about, if you want to know what Jesus wants from us as a church, if you want to know what Jesus wants from you as his follower, here it is, right at the beginning of the Sermon of the Mount. But before I get there, spoiler alert. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said things that made the original listeners go, what? And they sat there and they went, what? And he would just kind of dump things on them. He would say puzzling things, alarming things, and he would not explain them. He just said it and moved on to the next topic. He wanted people to kind of walk away going, what did he mean by that? Scratching their heads. He wanted them to sit with it for a while. So we're gonna do the same thing. Same thing. It's one of the reasons why we provide this daily devotional for you, so you can sit with these what statements that Jesus made during the week, because I think we need some head scratching time. So this is a head-scratching time for us, because the original impact of the Sermon on the Mount blew people away. So strap in, seatbelts on. Let's look at these four major themes really, really quickly. And the first one is this: shine your light. Shine your light. Right after he starts the Sermon on the Mount, he just did the Beatitudes. Right at the end of the Beatitudes, he says to all these people, you, and you, and you, and you, and you, you're salt of the earth. You're the light of the world. So let your light shine before people that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father who's in heaven. Now, there's an ancient Greek myth that was retold in a cartoon by Disney named Fantasia 2000. Have a look at this video and what they did. It's the myth of a goddess that would just kind of be invisible to human eyes, but whose presence was felt by the blessings that she left in her way. Trees buried by the snow, by the winter, would sprout, and new leaves, new life would pop up. Flowers would spring up in her footsteps. As she passed stagnant pools of water, they became clear and fresh. Parched fields turned green. And Jesus is saying, be like that. Let that be what people say about you. Not judgmental, not naysaying, not doomsday preaching, not eye rolling and finger wagging. Spread life and love wherever you go in the name and in the power of Jesus Christ. Have that kind of impact as a Christian. But here's what we do to Christianity, and it gets in the way. Very easily, most of our Christian life becomes all about winning the approval of your Christian superiors. And we all give that title to somebody. And it comes with a very heavy, heavy burden. You might give that title to a boss because you work in a Christian organization. It might be a parent. It might be a pastor or a life group leader or a person that led you to Christ or discipled you. It might be a speaker that comes across, a guest speaker that comes across with great authority when they preach. It might even be someone on YouTube that you've never ever met, but you watch continually and you give that title of Christian superior to that person and you try so hard to earn their approval. And if there are actual people that are in your actual life, you're always thinking, are they noticing me? Did they notice? Are they noticing that I'm having my daily quiet time? Are they noticing that I'm listening to all the right music? Do they notice that I'm wearing all the right non-revealing clothing? Are they noticing that I'm eating and drinking all the right food or not eating or not drinking the bad stuff? Are they noticing that I disapprove of everything they disapprove of? Are they noticing that I'm a good Christian? Or on the other side of the coin, are they noticing that I'm not too spiritual? Are they noticing that I'm a cool Christian and I throw in a bad word here and there every once in a while and I make enough off-color jokes just to show that I'm not like those Christians, I'm a cool Christian? And the question we get overly concerned about is, do other Christians see what a good Christian I am? What a waste of time. What a waste of energy, an incredibly relentless, heavy burden to constantly carry. See, Jesus wants you to shine, not for other religious people, because quite frankly, who cares what other church people think about you? Who cares what other religious people think about you? But instead, shine, he says, for the world to see, to be drawn to him. See, that's what Jesus is talking about in this verse. He's talking about, he's not talking about religious acts for religious people, but he's talking about doing good deeds for all people. He doesn't say, let your light shine in your rule keeping so that you can shine for your Christian superiors. He says, let your good deeds shine for all people, including the not yet followers of Jesus people that are in your life. He doesn't say, let your modesty shine so that people can see how faultlessly moral you are. He doesn't say, let the light of your Bible knowledge shine so that people may be amazed at how much you know. He doesn't say, let the light of your politics shine so that they can see how razor sharp consistent you are in your Christian worldview. He doesn't say any of that. Now, there's nothing wrong with Christian morality and Bible study and consistent politics. But he very specifically says, let your good deeds shine. See, that's what starts changing people's minds. That's what people notice. When we're a church that is known for something, not against something, when people see us actively and sacrificially doing common good activities for, not ourselves, not just for each other, do that, but for others, the impact is huge. Because what they say is, Jesus says, they praise. As a result, they praise. And they don't praise you individually, and they don't praise Central Baptist Church. They praise God because of these good deeds. See, the goal is not to get praise for ourselves. See, our goal, they may never ever say thank you to you. They may never say good job to you. You may never hear a word from them after you've done this really great sacrificial work for them. But that's not the goal. So don't wait around for it. The goal is that they might be brought closer to a relationship with God, one step at a time, because that's the point. See, it has nothing to do with you. It has nothing to do with us as a church. Our good deeds are not to score points with God, because that's not what he said. So we don't need to score points with God. He's already lavished on us what? Outrageous love and gifts and forgiveness and eternal life. Instead, he's saying, now use that. Use that life and those gifts and those resources that I have given you for others, that they may praise my Heavenly Father. Because your good deeds, your presence, your showing up when it counts, your friendship, your help, your resources, your networks, your kindness, your generosity, it lowers people's defenses to the good news. It lowers their defense and their defenses for the grace of God to enter into their lives. Jesus says, that's what I want you to be known for. That's what I want my followers to be known for, that wherever they go, there are lives being touched by your good deeds, and those lives are being brought to life. So he says, let your light shine. Let it. It's not, you don't have to force it. Just be a follower of Jesus and let it shine. So don't overschedule your light. I got no time to do good deeds for people. Don't only show your light to certain types of people. Don't tire of shining your light because, well, it's someone else's turn now. I've been doing this for decades. Let your light shine. And then number two, look to Jesus. Second theme, look to Jesus. This is a warning, but it's also an encouragement. See, it's very easy for Christians, for churches, to be all about good deeds and do lots of good things for the city and the neighbors and the neighborhoods, and they forget to look to Jesus. And Jesus is like, hey, excuse me, over here, remember this guy? It's actually about me. You know, let's not forget what this is all about. I am central to this. I am at the center of Scripture. You see, he says in this next verse, do not think that I've come to abolish the law or the prophets. I haven't come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. And this is really good news, because what he means by this is I've come to complete them. They are completed. See, the Bible says that he fulfilled the righteous requirements of the law so that we can get to heaven on his merit, not on ours. He completed the requirements of law for all humankind, and he fulfilled the law and the prophets in another way too. See, the Pharisees, they love to study Scripture, right? They love to study the Bible, but they miss the most important part, because all those prophecies from Genesis to Deuteronomy to Isaiah to Malachi to Daniel, all the prophecies, all the foreshadowing, it was foreshadowing of the Messiah, who was to be the Son of God, who was to come and fulfill it all. That's what the law and the prophets were all about. Yet somehow they couldn't see to what it was all pointing towards. Jesus saying that the law and the prophets were all pointing to me, nothing else. You do not have to fulfill them. You don't have to earn your way into heaven. I have done that. I have fulfilled them. You don't have to do the 2,000 plus additional rules and amendments and complications to try and understand what God was getting at. You just need to look to me. There's a line in the Chosen series that you can watch online, where Jesus invites Simon, who's not yet Peter, to follow him. They had just done the big catch of fish, and he says, follow me, and I'll make you fisher of people. And Simon looks at him and goes, what? And he goes, look, just bring people to me. I'll sort them out later. Simple. It's very simple. Simply look to Jesus, and the fulfillment of the law and the prophets are all right there. Simply point others to Jesus, and he'll sort out everyone else's personal complications. Then Jesus reminds them that a life following him is not just about good deeds and great grace, because it's easy to go there, right? I'm a good person, I do good things, I love Jesus, so therefore, you know, I can do whatever I want. He says, nah, you don't get to do whatever you want. He wants you to live the word. Live the word. He says, anyone who breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same, well, he'll be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever practices and teaches these commands will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. And that's the key word, practices. Practices is the key word in this verse. So let's talk about that a little bit. In fact, let's talk about Bible study here for a second. Most things you read and talk about Bible study said there are probably about five goals to Bible study. You do about five goals. The first one is complication. You can make the Bible very complicated. Pharisees did this. You can make the Bible seem so complicated and so obscure that you seem so smart and so wise because you're the only one who understands it and can teach it to your home group, your small group, your youth group, whatever. So that's one goal, is you can complicate it. Another goal, though, is that you can rationalize it, rationalization. And the Pharisees also did this. You can study the Bible and know it well enough to dodge all the personal accountability questions that might come your way. Because, well, it doesn't really apply to me. And you rationalize it all away. Look, but I love him, so it's okay. Or, but it's my personal choice, so it's okay. But they're so wrong, so I must. And we start to rationalize behavior. And Jesus says, that's not where you go either. Another goal is elaboration. And when it comes to scripture, you can add a lot of stuff over and over and over. You can be kind of nice about it, and sermons become more about your personal story than about the story of the Bible, and just tell lots of story. That's one way to elaborate. Or you can add a lot of extra theology and new revelations and extra rules into scripture of what the Bible says, which is what a lot of cults do. But then there's another goal of Bible study, and that's education. And you know a lot about things about the Bible, about God, about Jesus, about this and about that. And there's nothing wrong with knowing about that, about education around the Bible, unless it comes the end instead of the means to the end. See, the Pharisees loved that too. They wrote reams and reams and reams of commentary on every little word in the Bible. And the trouble was that while they were doing this, they were losing the forest for all the individual trees. And Jesus is saying here, look, the goal's not complication. It's not rationalization. It's not elaboration or education, anything else. The goal of knowing the Word, the living Word of God, is application. Application. That when you study the Bible, your life will be changed. Your behavior will be changed. Your attitudes towards people will be changed. Your soul will be transformed. It's called Nike theology. Just do it. Just do it. Simple. Love your neighbor. Simple. Loving that neighbor, that's kind of hard. But choosing to, because the Bible says to, well, that's simple. Do not judge. Simple. Do not judge that behavior? Well, that's kind of hard. But choosing not to because the Bible says not to? That's simple. See, Jesus is saying that when it comes to the Bible, simple three words. Just do it. Just do it. It isn't about salvation and earning your way into heaven. The Bible is very clear that it only comes through faith in Jesus as your Lord and Savior. This is about your response to the Bible. What's the Bible to you? When you read it, what is it to you? Is it a book of trivia? Is it a book of history? Is it a book of interesting facts? Like, oh, I didn't know that. Tamar, bad story. Is it a book of facts that make you feel better about yourself? Wow, he loves me. Is it a book of poetry? Is it a work of art? Or is the Bible your Bible? There's a special on TV that I saw about Jurassic Park. And it's about when Universal Studios made Jurassic Park, they made a clay model. You'll see it in the corner. I put a little circle around it. They made a clay model of the big T-Rex that was in the movie. And they said that this clay model was their Bible. It was their Bible. Every time they wanted to build a T-Rex robot, every time they needed to build the T-Rex puppet, every time they needed to create a T-Rex computer graphic, even when they made the Universal Studios ride of Jurassic Park, they knew what the T-Rex needed to look like because they kept going back to the clay model. And they referred to the clay model in this little documentary as, this is our Bible. They actually said that. This clay model is our Bible. And Jesus is saying, I got an idea, guys. Why not make the Bible your Bible? Let's give that a try for a while. And that's how he launches into his ministry, the Sermon on the Mount. And then he brings the last theme, the fourth theme that he wants from me, the fourth theme that he's going to keep going back to throughout all his ministry. And this is the big one. This is the one we don't want to miss. This is the big one. Number four, he says, you know your Bible, but now go beyond rule keeping. Go beyond it. See, this is the key to understanding the whole rest of the Sermon on the Mount. This is the verse. This is the key verse. And Jesus says, for I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven. And they're sitting there going, oh, I am so doomed. I'm so doomed. See, remember the scribes and the Pharisees, they were the record holders when it came to righteousness. They were holy men. They made up all those thousands and thousands of rules, and they memorized them, and they did all of them. There were Pharisees that were so afraid to look at another woman because they might accidentally lust that they had a cowl over their head, and they would just walk around looking down all the time. They literally bumped into walls their whole life. They would walk into walls and tables, and they were known as the bruised and bleeding ones. That's what they were referred to as, and that was a term of honor. And the people on the mount are hearing Jesus say this, that my righteousness has to surpass that. Well, forget it. I don't have a chance. Just forget it. It's impossible to be holier than the bruised and bleeding ones with their 2,000 rules. So what's he getting at? What is Jesus getting at? Let me tell you a story. One day, Jesus was invited to speak in a Jewish synagogue, but the Bible tells us that he was invited to the synagogue for all the wrong reasons. He was invited as a setup. It was like a sting operation, right? It was like a spiritual trap. This is how it worked. One of the laws of the Old Testament, one of the Ten Commandments, was to rest on the Sabbath, right? Rest on the Sabbath. So awesome law, right? Take a day off, get a rest once a week, honor God. But the Pharisees added like 300 different extensions to that one law, keep the Sabbath. For example, you cannot pick up a bucket on the Sabbath because that's work. So don't do it. You can only lift a certain weight of a fork. And if the fork was too heavy, then you couldn't use it to eat because that would be work. They actually created a new reserve drawer of Sabbath forks that were lighter and smaller. I think it's where the cake fork was invented. I don't know. But that's how dumb the rules had gotten, all right? That's how crazy it all gotten. So these guys decided to trap Jesus publicly and catch him in this dramatic violation of doing work on the Sabbath. So they went to Jesus, and they said, Jesus, oh, we would love, would you come speak at our synagogue? We would love if you come speak at our synagogue. And he goes, yeah, come on, let's go. I'll do that. So he gets there, but this is how sick these Pharisees were. They combed the city to find a disabled person. And they're walking around, and they're looking for someone with some kind of disfigurement, the kind of person that Jesus couldn't help but have to heal, right? And so they look at that one. Oh, that's too obvious. That's too obvious. No, that's not obvious enough. Oh, there's a guy. Perfect. And they found a guy who had a shriveled up hand, shriveled up arm, and they said, he's perfect because we can hide it, and then when it's too late, we can reveal it, and then we'll see what Jesus does, and we've got him. So they go up to the guy, and they go, mate, how you doing, mate? Tell you what, we like to invite you as our guest to the synagogue. We would love you to come and hear from Jesus. In fact, we'll reserve a seat for you at the very front row of the synagogue so you can be right there, and when he starts talking, you can raise your hand and ask a question. Because that's how much we want you to enjoy your time with Jesus. Okay? And he's like, yeah, We'll do that. Pretending to care, totally using this guy for this trap. So the day comes, and the place is packed. Everyone's come to hear Jesus. And this little guy with the shriveled arms in the front row, Jesus gets up, starts to speak, starts doing his sermon, and the guy kind of slips up his hand because I've heard he heals people. I'm like, if he sees me, why would I not ask, right? I've got to ask. And so he slips his hand up where Jesus can see it, and the Bible tells us that Jesus' heart was stirred with compassion for this guy. His heart breaks for this guy, and he stops in mid-speech and to do some healing. And what he does, he notices as he stops and as he's leaning forward, he notices that every scribe and every Pharisee in the synagogue has now moved to the edge of their seat, and they're wringing their heads like, oh, we got him. Why, he's going to heal him on the Sabbath. We got him. And he looks at it, and Jesus assesses the situation, and the Bible tells us in Mark 3, verse 5, that he was grieved and angered at the hardness of their hearts. Not the hardness of their hearts towards him, he expected that. It was the hardness of their hearts towards the little guy in the front row with the shriveled up arm. Jesus knows it's a trap, but out loud in front of everybody, he says, the guy, be healed. And instantly, his arm's fine and it's healed. And at that minute, before the cheers of the synagogue could even start happening, the Pharisees stand up and they clear the room. They say, okay, church's over, everybody out. And they come together and they go, okay, we got him. Let's get together. And they go in the back room and they start scheming on how they're going to use this to destroy him because he publicly broke a major law of working on the Sabbath. They weren't thrilled about the healing. They weren't concerned about the little guy with the shriveled arm. They weren't worshiping God, who they just saw do the coolest thing that they have ever seen happen in any of their synagogue services. Their only focus was on their self-righteous rules. And it ticked Jesus off. He was angry. So Jesus is saying on the Sermon Mount with this verse, he's saying, be better than those guys. Just be better than the rule-keeping guys. He's saying, I want you to go from rules to relationship. See, a little later on, after the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 15, the Pharisees come to Jesus and they say, look, we got a problem with you. We noticed that when your disciples were gathered, they were washing their hands and they didn't do it according to the ceremonial rules, and the water did not drip down to their elbows. We pay attention to this kind of stuff. This is important to us. And we noticed that it didn't happen. There ain't no elbow dripping going on with your disciples. And Jesus probably shaking his head going, you gotta be kidding me. Seriously? This is what you're concerned about? And he says, you guys like the Bible, right? So let me quote a Bible verse for you from the prophet Isaiah. And he says this that you see on the screen. These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. And he nailed them with that. They were nailed. That was like 2,000 years ago. What's that have to do with us now? What about you and me? See, the question Jesus is asking here is, where's your heart? Where's your heart in all this? See, he wants us to go from a performance idea of Christianity to a passionate life with him. What did he say to the Pharisees? He said, everything they do is done for others to see. It's all about performance. It's all about looking Baptist or looking Pentecostal or looking Anglican or whatever your church tradition is. When I was in year 7 intermediate school, we had to learn ballroom dancing in PE. And my coach, my gridiron coach, Coach Trinidad, he got us all in the gym. We're all lined up in the gym, and he shouted at us like we were on the gridiron field. And he goes, all right, people, today we're going to learn about the essentials of ballroom dancing. Prepare yourselves. Now pair up. Like, this is an all-guys PE class. And these like PE shirts that we've been wearing for a week. It's a Friday, like, and so we're like pairing up and put my hand on what? I'm not putting my hand on his waist. What? And then he put on this scratchy old record on the old school district turntable, and he goes, "All right, men, here's your steps. One, two, three, left, right, left, right. And we're nervous and we're sweating and we're trying not to touch each other's waist. And like, it was no fun, man. It was all about the steps and looking right. Why would you want to dance? My goodness, put me off dancing. And then he yells, "Crumb! Crumb!" And he's in front of everybody. He goes, "It's left, right, left, right. It's not left, left, right, right trip. Get it right or you're coming up here and you're dancing with me." Now I'm already freaking out. And that's religion. That's religion. Learn the right steps. Read your Bible. Have your quiet time. Awesome. Pray. That's essential. Go to church. Fellowship with one another. Absolutely crucial. But do it my way. Right, left, right, left. And somehow all the joy gets marched right out of it. And I'm like, I know I'm doing the right steps in Christianity, but there's no life in this. It's not fun. I don't know why anyone would choose to do this. It's boring. It's boring. I have better things to do on a Sunday morning. I hate the music. I can't get through about a few verses of the Bible without falling asleep. This Christianity thing is driving me crazy, and the pastor coach keeps yelling at me, right, right, left, left, wrong, wrong, no, stop it. And it's like, I just never got the whole dancing thing. Never got it. And then, one day, I got to dance with my wife. And I love dancing. It was early in our relationship. We went to the States for Carson's wedding. My nephew. It was an outdoor wedding in Arizona. The sun comes down, the whole desert turns orange, and there's, you know, cactus and stuff, and it was outside, winter air in Arizona, which is still like 45 degrees. Vintage festoon lights are glowing off of Rachel's beautiful blonde hair. I don't know any dance steps, and I loved it. I loved the whole moment of it because I was with her. And we danced, and we laughed. And I could see in Rachel's eyes, she really loves me. And I know I'm going to love loving her for the rest of my life. See, dancing, it's not about the steps. It's not about the one, two, three, one, two, three, left, right, left, right. It's not what makes dancing fun. What makes dancing fun is the person you're dancing with. And there's a romance there. There's a love there. There's a passion there. And there's a relationship that you're captivated by. See, following Jesus is not about learning the right steps. I mean, that's what Jesus was trying to tell everybody at the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount. Following Jesus is about responding to his invitation to dance with me. See, if Christianity has just felt like you're just trying to learn the right steps, reading the Bible, prayer, going to church, doing good deeds, and those are all good things, but you're like, I'm kind of over it because it's the same old thing, same old thing. Good stuff, and God bless the people that want to do that, but it's just not fun anymore. What Jesus is saying is, look in my eyes. See how much I love you. Because that's what this is about. Not follow me and I'll teach you the right dance steps. Left, right, okay, now let's go walk on water. That's not it. It's more. It's dance with me. Let me show you the joy of following my Father in heaven. And then suddenly you can't put the Bible down. And you want to read every page until you fall asleep with that Bible open because it's like a personal letter written to you from Jesus. Suddenly you want to pray because you're basking in the love of God's presence and in the love that God has for you. And you're gazing into the face of the one who gave his life for you. Suddenly, you want to do good stuff and good deeds for other people because you are overflowing with love for the person that you are dancing with. And you desperately want other people to know Jesus the way you know him. That's when you want to love your neighbor because you love Jesus so much. How could I not want everybody else to love him the same way? Suddenly, dancing goes from doing the right steps to just grooving. Because you're in love with the Savior. Because simply put, this is what it all comes down to. Another time, Jesus was asked by the Pharisees, because they're trying to figure him out. They're like, Jesus, what's your favorite rule? Because Pharisees love talking about the rules, right? They loved it. What's your favorite rule? And one goes, yeah, like I like the light fork one. I love that little fork. It just kind of picks up. I love that fork. And the other one's going like, I love the elbow dripping. I just like the way it feels when it goes down my arm and I can hear it go bloop, bloop. I know I'm doing it right. And the other one's like, I like not looking in the mirror because look at me. I don't want to look in the mirror. He goes, Jesus, what's your favorite rule? And Jesus says, well, simple. Love your Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength, and love your neighbor as you love yourself. He's saying, simply put, just live with a genuine, from the heart love for God and for everybody else. So where are you at? Where's your heart? Are you going to be able to get used to this new Christianity thing, this different kind of Christianity thing? Because that's what Jesus invites us to. That's where the real righteousness starts. I'm going to ask the worship team to please come on up. And we're going to pray, and then I'm going to introduce communion. And what I want to ask you to do is, as we do communion, as you come up and take the element and go back to your seat, before you eat the bread, before you drink the cup, I want you to just have a moment and look at your heart. Where's your heart? Have you allowed your Christianity to become a religion? And is it time for you to empower it to be a loving relationship with Jesus again? Are you focused on all the right steps and keeping all the right people happy and you're losing the joy? What I want to ask you is, before you take the bread, before you take the cup, just say, Jesus, I'm sorry. I want to dance again. I don't know a single step. You take the lead. I'll follow. I just want to laugh. I want to dance again. And I want to love life again. I want to love family and neighbors and workmates and schoolmates. I want to love you again, and I want to feel your love again. So I'm sorry that I've let rules and time frames get in the way. I mean, it's so complicated. Please just help me. Help me to make it about you again. Because that's what Jesus did. He showed up at the Sermon on the Mount, and he says, look, it's about me. It's not about other things. Same way on that last night when he was with the disciples, before he was betrayed, before he was arrested, before he was crucified, before he rose again and ascended to heaven, he took the bread and he broke it. He says, this is my body given to you. I'm giving myself to you. As often as you eat with others, remember me. Don't just remember what I did. Remember that I want to dance with you now. And then he took the cup. He says, this is my new covenant. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I will be standing beside you all the time. All you got to do is look and you'll see me. So as often as you drink the cup and eat the bread, you do it in remembrance of Jesus, of what he's done for you, how he died for you, how he forgave your sins, how he's given you abundant life. And then you remember how he wants you to live that abundant life with fun and laughter and joy and love and dance. So God, we take these elements not as a religious exercise, but as a reminder of how much you love us, a reminder of the joy it is to live with you, and a reminder that you want us to dance without knowing any of the steps and simply follow you into the life of others, because it's about you and your Father in heaven and your love for us. In Jesus' name, amen. As the music plays, please come forward, take an element back to someone you sit next to if they can't come up on their own. Take some time, say, sorry, Jesus, I just want to dance again, and then take the elements. Thank you.
Tongue of tongue.
Holy Spirit, give us the desire to open our eyes and redirect our stare away from religious rules and the way things are supposed to be, and back onto the eyes of Jesus, who look at us with such a deep love that reminds us of the love you, Father God, have for us, and help us to live for that, and to live into that, and then to spread that to others, that as people cross our paths, they are amazed by the good deeds and the love and the kindness that they experience, but they can't name it and they can't put it on us. And so somehow, Holy Spirit, they redirect it back to our Father in heaven. Help us be those kind of people, those kind of followers of Jesus, that kind of church that love you more than the way things are supposed to be and trust you enough to follow you into different, to be light that we want to shine to the world so that people will praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much for joining us this Sunday. Thank you for joining us online. Happy Father's Day. Our amazing hospitality team has put together a manly morning tea. I think it's cucumber sandwiches and broccoli florets and things. So go on out there and enjoy some veggies, guys. And we'll see you next Sunday. God bless.